McGraw-Hill Ascent Audio presents The Automation Advantage. Embrace the future of productivity and improve speed, quality, and customer experience through AI. By Bhaskar Ghosh, PhD, Rajendra Prasad, and Gayathri Pallail. Narrated by Emmanuel Chumaceiro. Foreword by Julie Sweet, CEO of Accenture. The COVID-19 pandemic made it very clear that technology is a lifeline for economies, governments, organizations, and people. It not only helped us solve immediate challenges and stay connected with one another, it also changed the way we see and understand the world. Automation, the focus of this insightful and extremely practical book, is no small part of this change. Like many other technologies, automation advanced greatly over the past decade with the rise of intelligent systems, encompassing capabilities like applied artificial intelligence, AI, industrial and process robotics, and service robots. Now, due to the impact of the pandemic, the pace of automation innovation is moving much faster than we anticipated. There is no better guide to automation than Bhaskar Ghosh, Accenture's Chief Strategy Officer and former Group Chief Executive of Accenture Technology Services. I have worked with him for many years, and his invaluable vision and counsel have helped countless companies through their digital transformations. In The Automation Advantage, Bhaskar and his co-authors, Rajendra Prasad and Gayathri Pallail, draw on their veteran expertise to explain how automation works and how it works best. They cut through the myths and misunderstandings to blaze a clear trail for any business leader looking to develop an automation strategy, create new value, and realize growth, all with a human-centric approach. Because like all technologies, automation should never be considered in isolation. It's always in the context of solving human problems. I often tell other CEOs that if someone comes to them and says, "I have an automation project," or "I have a blockchain initiative," they should say, "No." They shouldn't even ask what it is, because no initiative should ever start with technology. Ultimately, technology enables. It's about empowering people. Currently, we estimate that we are at only 15 to 20% of what could be automated. We're going to see that percentage rapidly increase as automation continues to spread from manual processes, such as building cars in a factory, to enhancing mental processes, such as giving a consumer a consistently better customer experience. Automation is helping companies actively grow their business through speed, safety, quality, cost efficiency, and resilience. Seizing this opportunity, companies are investing in this technology and creating jobs. But are people ready and able to fill them? Are young people leaving high school with basic technology skills and digital literacy? The answer in many cases is no. Before the pandemic, we were not ready to address the growing global reskilling need that automation is bringing. Unfortunately, we still are not prepared. As companies, we have a huge responsibility to reskill, and it is imperative that we bring together government, educational institutions, and not-for-profits with equal speed to partner on addressing this need. As we enter the post-pandemic era, we are seeing a world awakened to an incredible opportunity to reimagine and rebuild responsibly and sustainably. Instead of seeing automation as a technology that competes with people for jobs, it can and should be considered a way to contribute to our shared success. By eliminating mundane and repetitive tasks, automation allows us to focus human attention where it's most needed, on creativity, empathy, and critical thinking. The Automation Advantage helps us understand not only how automation can create value for a business, but also how its unique combination of technology and human ingenuity can play a part in transforming the global economy into one that works for the benefit of all. Preface: Sharing What Works. The year is 2019, and the place is a beautifully furnished meeting room in a modern office tower, the headquarters of a global company. We've come to town to meet with a management team considering a complex operational business issue, which we think presents a great opportunity for intelligent automation. We're confident we can make a case for this with the information we've assembled, which anticipates the questions these executives will probably have. First, they'll likely ask, what is intelligent automation? Answer, it's the new era of automation in which machines are used to perform tasks formerly reserved for humans, tasks that involve analyzing data, making decisions, and learning from what follows once decisions are implemented. Second, they'll ask, why should we invest in automation like this? Will it really make us a better company? Answer, your competitive edge will still depend more than ever on your people's talents, but you'll be able to leverage and augment those talents to an unprecedented level. Third, are other companies in our industry already moving in this direction, and is it paying off? Answer, yes, we've done our research. Finally, they'll ask, given our other priorities, why is now the right time to invest? But as the meeting begins, the surprise is on us. These aren't the questions the executives ask. As we share our thoughts on known pain points in their type of business and how automation could help, the executives are already nodding and pushing us along. This is a group already convinced that the opportunities are exceptional. It turns out there have been pockets of experimentation going on in their organization, and these limited, one-off solutions have been yielding seriously good results, so this top team wants to take things to the next level. They're past the why questions and well into the how. As they aim to approach the automation opportunity at scale, they want to know where to start, how to identify top business cases and how to determine the priority order in which to address them, how to assess their legacy systems and data issues that might delay them. They also wonder how they can be sure their people, both the technology staff and the business users of the new tools, will value the change and want to be part of it. It turned out to be the best boardroom conversation we'd had all year, as we found ourselves talking excitedly about the very issues consuming us personally at the moment. We'd been working with a variety of leading companies that had reached the same scaling point in their intelligent automation journeys, and we had been able to identify important patterns, the common pitfalls, and the clever solutions that cut across their companies. As a technology consulting team with a practice area to lead, we had been pulling together these lessons and trying to distill them into practical guidance on designing and implementing successful automation projects. Now, the observations were gelling into insights that we knew could genuinely accelerate an organization's progress. And guess what? The following month, we had a very similar conversation with another company's management team. Also jumping ahead to the how questions, and then a great workshop with yet another right after that. We found ourselves repeating key messages and refining them, figuring out how best to organize and articulate the principles we were developing in practice. Eventually, we felt like we had covered all the major bases and developed a point of view on each of them, whether in a white paper, blog post, speech, methodology module, or presentation deck. However, we felt we should really pull them together into one coherent package. One of us named the challenge at that point. That would require a whole book. And here we are. The book you have right now is designed to answer that smart set of burning questions we continue to be asked by managers and leaders who want to proceed quickly and confidently in automation initiatives. But if we're setting the whole context for how this book came about, we also have to mention that other big source of pressure that hit organizations all around the world in 2020. Much as we might all want to forget it, we were well into the process of writing the book when COVID-19 hit, and we, our company, and all our clients found ourselves struggling to protect our people, help our customers, and remain productive amid a devastating pandemic. We know and work with many academics, management gurus, and analysts focused on the realm of intelligent automation, and sometimes we envy their situations. For some of them, a lockdown on global travel and orders to work from home made this a year when they suddenly had more capacity to reflect and write. For us, it was a crazy time of demand for client solutions, as automation became more important than ever. This was an urgent realization by many firms. As early as April 2020, Information Age reported that HFS Research surveyed 631 major enterprises about how they anticipated the pandemic would affect their strategies and operations. One of its questions asked, "How do you expect COVID-19 to impact your spending?" In 10 major areas of technology investment, fully 55% of respondents knew already that their spending on automation would increase, making this the second most reported increase after cybersecurity. Both obvious concerns, as so much mission-critical work moved abruptly to online platforms. For us, the challenges came simultaneously on many fronts in our client projects, every one of which is unique, and also within our own company. Accenture itself moved instantly to new modes of staying productive, away from the consulting industry norm by which professionals spend the bulk of their time on site at client locations and generate much of their value through in-person working sessions. The companies we had already been helping with automation seemed most eager to double down on that work. For companies seeking hyper-automation before, where discrete automated tasks roll up into seamlessly automated processes and automated analysis identifies for itself new opportunities to take automation into new realms, the pandemic crisis pushed those ambitions further. Having a book to complete in the midst of all this was not what we had anticipated when we signed the contract with our publisher. Yet there was a silver lining too. We think the fact that we were so deeply in the mode of capturing and explaining principles from real-world engagements made it easier for us to make sense of this new, very dynamic and frankly unnerving situation. In many ways, this book represents the synthesis of long experience. The real veteran among us is Bhaskar Ghosh, who has spent a career as an automation advocate and been responsible for many groundbreaking solutions. He and RP, as all of Rajendra Prasad's friends and colleagues call him, have worked together on many of these, ranging from small projects to large transformations. Since then, often with Gayathri Pallail leading the charge, we have helped many clients apply intelligent automation to remove pain points in risk management, sales strategy, customer service, and more. As Accenture's work in this area increased, we also found ways to make our own company's internal processes more effective, using automation solutions like workflow systems. The human factor is also critical. We've approached our internal automation opportunities with creativity, empathy, and innovation in the spirit of keeping the human advantage front and center for organizations we work with. In any situation where people must solve a complex problem, we're convinced they can do it better if augmented by robust automation. Along the way, we've seen our colleagues make many technical and managerial breakthroughs. In fact, as we began work on this book, the news came that Accenture had just been granted its 60th patent related to intelligent automation. To us, this is a real point of pride. We noted already that we stay close to the discoveries being made by leading researchers in universities, startups, and research and development labs. The work they do is invaluable to us. But meanwhile, our great privilege is that we are able to innovate in the setting of a global professional services company, where we work with the world's largest and most sophisticated companies. Their managers and leaders are inspirational. They are eager to get real innovation done. The problems they need to solve matter to their success and to the world. Working where we do also means that we benefit from a culture that prizes discovery and the documentation and dissemination of it to the world. This is evident from the constant stream of forward-looking research that Accenture publishes in every form imaginable. From podcasts to survey reports to high-level strategy books, in a company that invests heavily in staying at the cutting edge, it is a cultural value that we should have research-backed perspectives to offer our clients and other stakeholders. But while we earn for our patents for innovations that are specialized and technology-focused, it is critical that our client-serving teams can connect those with the problems of clients, even when the client involved is dealing with a highly strategic issue and talking in very big-picture terms. To our people, it may be clear that the patented tool or technique directly contributes to the client solution, but it isn't always obvious to others. A book like this can equip more people in the business world with the storyline that explains why this fast-evolving intelligent automation technology is so important to achieve business objectives and what it takes to put it in place at scale. To be clear, this is not a strategy book. It's an execution book. Our self-assigned mission was to produce a truly practical guide. So yes, we devote an opening chapter to offering some historical context on automation and making the case for why it is now the time to invest in cognitive technologies. But we then move quickly into content relevant to organizations who already sense there is a big opportunity and want to translate that enthusiasm into action. We identify the most common barriers to acting on that sense in Chapter 2 as a way of setting up the value of what follows. All of it is geared toward overcoming these obstacles. In Chapter 3, we emphasize the need to be clear on strategic intent because a shared commitment to the business priorities is the necessary North Star to guide every aspect of planning and implementation. This strategic imperative segues directly into Chapter 4, which focuses on how to choose wisely from the seemingly endless opportunities most organizations face to automate some activity or another. Hint: it has as much to do with overall capability building and intelligent automation maturity as with the potential bottom line impact of individual solutions. Throughout, we place emphasis on what it takes to derive the highest value from investments, and we address very ground-level problems and considerations. In Chapter 5, we explain how to map out an implementation plan, put governance in place, and keep track of progress. In Chapter 6, we get into technology discussions on how to architect a future-proof automation at a level that is understandable to not just the technology team, but also other functional executives and general managers. In Chapter 7, we discuss the soft stuff that all experienced leaders know is really the hard stuff: change management, reskilling, organizational culture, and other elements of people management. At a high level, we underscore the takeaway advice at the end of each chapter, but we urge you to delve deep into the stories that bring the advice to life and the research findings that back up its validity. Our objective in the text has been to write to that all-important mid-level that helps the most strategic thinkers in organizations understand the art of the possible and helps the most focused tool builders and technologists make the connections between their work and the overall strength and agility of the enterprise. As you'll see, the metaphor and concept of a roadmap turns out to be very important to that overall success. It gets introduced early and reiterated often. Chapter 8 emphasizes that this is not a journey that has an end. There is always effort required to sustain and build on the gains, and without that effort, there's a real risk of backsliding. Finally, Chapter 9 gives a glimpse of where the journey may take organizations in the future as they use automation to achieve new levels of relevance, responsibility, and resilience. Our hope is that with this book, we are putting a valuable map into your hands. It reflects the long road we have taken, as we learned from years of complex business challenges and then the crisis of a global pandemic, as we helped our most sophisticated clients transform from manual operations to automated and, in some cases, hyper-automated ones. But now it is your map to keep drawing. As you embark on your organization's own intelligent automation journey, we wish you every success on it. We are happy if our experience can provide some guideposts along the way, and we look forward to learning more from what you are able to achieve. Chapter 1: The Intelligence Imperative. A few years ago, one of Italy's leading daily regional newspapers, Il Secolo 19, introduced a new form of automation to its operations that, to some eyes, seemed audacious. As a large for-profit business serving a mass market, Il Secolo already depended on automation in many forms. The very genesis of its business was one of the most impactful automation technologies in history, the printing press. And more recently, it had transformed itself around the internet and digital technology. In fact, Il Secolo has long been one of the most forward-thinking papers in Italy, having pioneered color printing, integrated newsrooms, multi-channel digital presence, and social media engagement. This new automation project, however, struck some as moving in a dramatically different direction. This time, the tasks being automated were part of the intellectual work of journalists, the highly educated and creative workers at the very heart of Il Secolo's premium product. Like many newspapers, Il Secolo faced serious challenges. The number of readers was contracting and revenues were dropping. The leadership at Il Secolo 19 understood that sustaining and growing a loyal readership meant continuously rethinking what it means to be a newspaper, and doing so at the nonstop pace of a modern 24/7, 365 newsroom. They realized they needed to find new ways to produce cost-effective, high-quality journalism to increase digital traffic, reader loyalty, and company revenues. The solution? A virtual assistant that would boost its writers' and editors' productivity without compromising quality, consisting of artificial intelligence-infused software. The virtual assistant was designed to leverage human talents and streamline the process of producing digital content. Now, when a journalist starts a story, the assistant continuously checks the text for data consistency, potential links to other sources, as well as spelling and syntax, by offering journalists prompts to other content it thinks will be relevant, whether from previous stories or external resources. The assistant gives journalists a completely new way to check sources, develop background understanding, and, more important, add extra content they might have otherwise missed. Far from feeling threatened by their new virtual colleague, workers in Il Secolo's newsroom welcomed the support. In 6 months, every journalist on staff was using the technology. Many of Il Secolo's journalists found the virtual assistant not only saved time, but also stimulated new thoughts, prompting them to consider different angles, enriching their understanding, and revealing non-obvious connections to other stories already published or in the works. At the enterprise level, the virtual assistant is translating strategy to reality. More abundant, high-quality content provides more opportunities to attract advertising and to grow revenues with digital subscriptions. Il Secolo's success story is just one of many unfolding today under the broad banner of intelligent automation. It is a good case to start with because it has all the basic elements of the much wider trend. Intelligent automation involves the application of smart machines, taking advantage of the various technologies that are collectively referred to as artificial intelligence, AI. It applies these tools to work performed by knowledge workers, a realm that has long been resistant to automation, and it calls for intelligent management of the automation process to ensure uptake by the organization to deploy the resources available for automation to the highest value opportunities and to integrate the new solution into a richly interconnected business system. In Il Secolo's case, automating a piece of the content creation workflow had implications for printing timelines, editorial assignments, ad sales, page layouts, and even human resources planning. All these elements had to be considered to create a coherent, structured plan. Like many great newspapers around the world, Il Secolo regularly reports on advances in AI. One recent story, for example, highlighted software made by the American company Affectiva and the Japanese company Empath that is designed to detect people's emotions. Perhaps aided by the virtual assistant, the article referenced the name of a famous science fiction story of the 1960s. Do androids dream of electric sheep? If it was possible to speculate in the 1960s, the reporter noted in the story, that computers were capable of unconscious cognitive activity, then maybe we shouldn't be surprised that they could evolve to pick up on the unspoken feelings of others around them. But even as reporters in this news organization have their eyes on the future of intelligent automation, they are, in their own jobs, making practical use of it very much in the present. They are part of a traditional business moving headlong into the digital age, reinventing itself to continue to thrive. Automation's new era. Automation is not a very old word. It was coined less than 75 years ago when a Ford engineering manager named Del Harder named the department that would oversee the company's growing research and experimentation in replacing assembly line workers with machines. Essentially, Harder took the noun automation, meaning a robot or other type of self-operating mechanism, and turned it into the verb to automate. The term took off as fast as the technology. Automating work was a breakthrough productivity changer when it arrived in big industrial corporations in the mid-20th century. To be sure, the much earlier machines of the Industrial Revolution, starting with spinning jennies, power looms, water frames, and such, also represented automation, even if the term was not yet in use. But it was the scale attained by industrial businesses by the 1940s that turned automation into a discipline and constant quest. Mass production facilities made the economics of designing, engineering, and deploying capital equipment attractive in a way that they had never been before. As at Ford, the focus across industries was on making manufacturing processes faster and cheaper, as well as safer and more capable of producing consistent quality, by substituting machine power for human labor. Workers had always used tools, but automation meant handing work over to a tool itself. By the turn of the millennium, machinery was pervasive across industrial settings, reducing to a fraction the former effort that had been required to produce goods. Automation had fully advanced into its next era. If there is a single biggest story to be told about the transformation of the world's leading economies over the 20th century, it's about their shift from being manufacturing-based to being service-based. Data from the U.S. Bureau of Labor Statistics shows that, after a wartime high in 1943, employment in the nation's manufacturing sector has dropped nearly constantly. As a share of total employment, manufacturing accounted for 37.9% of jobs in 1943. In 2018, it accounted for just 8.5% of jobs. Meanwhile, service jobs, first largely in retail and more recently in healthcare and social assistance, skyrocketed. Today, and since the end of 2017, healthcare accounts for the largest number of jobs in the U.S. economy, followed closely by the retail trade. With this shift came a growing awareness that the services economy, too, consisted of much repetitive, standardized labor, and a sense that automation could reduce the amount of human labor in services, just as it had done in manufacturing. In banking, for example, Barclays Bank asked some 50 years ago, could we automate the bulk of a teller's work? And the ATM, the automated teller machine, was born. Within a decade, retailers spotted their own opportunity, and a grocery store in Troy, Ohio, made history in 1974 with the first barcode scan of a product. It was a pack of Wrigley's Juicy Fruit Gum. The questions have since become more ambitious. In healthcare, for example, could automation make diagnosis of maladies quicker and more accurate? Could the ability to analyze trillions of data points across a patient population lead to more evidence-based treatments? Could surgeons be assisted in real time by virtual agents monitoring patient vital statistics and performing on-the-spot pathology? The healthcare system, with its many inefficiencies and an extreme need for best practice performance, would seem to be ripe for much more automation, but only if the automation is intelligent. This wave of automation was not limited, moreover, to those companies designated by government statisticians as service providers versus manufacturers. Even within manufacturing companies, because they had so thoroughly automated their production processes, payrolls were newly dominated by knowledge workers. Even at companies traditionally known as manufacturers, there are armies of people performing back office and front office roles whose jobs consist mainly of information processing, greatly outnumbering the human beings on the shop floors. We are now in the newest era of automation, when it's clear that much of the office work that computers have enabled people to do more productively can actually be computerized, whereas in the past, automation was relegated to the realm of largely manual labor. Now it has entered the world of intellectual work. Again, it isn't as though these managers, administrators, and professional workers lacked for tools before. As they performed their largely information processing-oriented tasks, they made use of communications technologies, at least since the days of telegraphs and telephones, and information technologies as rudimentary as typewriters and adding machines. It was only when this toolkit evolved, however, into modern computing technology that it seemed possible that intellectual work might be automated in the way that so much of manual labor had been. From efficiency to excellence. Automation projects were first embraced with the compelling but limited goal of efficiency. Using a growing set of technologies, individual workers could be made more productive. The same goods in the same quantity could be produced in far less time, at far less expense, and with far less human effort. At a time when product and labor markets were less complex, the direct effects of this efficiency on the economics of a business, the ability to offer lower prices to customers, and the chance to expand profit margins made the justification for investment in automation simple. Soon, however, as markets evolved and enterprises grew, another enormous benefit of automation became clear. Beyond boosting the efficiency of individual workers, investments in automation equipment allowed for more rapid scaling of enterprises into industrial powerhouses. Factory automation equipment allowed for more tightly controlled quality, greater throughput, and supply chain optimization. Now, in a 21st century economy consisting of multinational corporations operating at a global scale, managers are looking to an ever-evolving set of technology options to support the creation of business value that encompasses more than improved efficiency and can produce scale-driven gains. We are seeing a shift from the era of industrialized automation to a new era of intelligent automation, in which the prior focus on the costs that can be cut transitions to a new focus on the customer experience, business excellence, service improvements, innovations, and smart strategic decisions. In other words, automation increasingly is being viewed as a way to boost top-line performance as well as bottom-line savings. As part of this, we are seeing fast growth in investments in automation applications, not just for back-office productivity improvements behind the scenes, but also to support the front office of interacting with clients and customers. This is not an either/or situation. Much value generation will still come in the form of cost reduction, but the emergence of intelligent automation will also reveal many more strategically important opportunities for top-line growth and enhanced service quality. Increasingly, companies will aim beyond cost reduction targets and use automation to enhance the customer experience, the business's ability to create value, and its revenue growth, which are all keys to remaining relevant in the future. This new era of business value creation through automation will be marked by constant, rapid development of cognitive automation technologies. It will also be an era when managers expand their ambitions from implementing particular automation tools and solving one-off problems to establishing broad automation platforms that support and accelerate problem-solving with automation throughout the business. We should expect the adoption of automation to grow exponentially as a result. Indeed, this trend has already been established. Investments in intelligent automation have increased dramatically in recent years. As reported in Forbes, one analyst organization predicts that the market for robotic process automation alone will add up to $12 billion by 2023. With so many companies now embarked on a transformational journey to become digital enterprises and learning fast from technology leaders, the foundations for more applications of automation in information processing work are being laid. Combined with rapid advances in technologies related to AI, this digital revolution in business is creating endless possibilities for gaining value from machines that can sense, learn, and act. Today, surveys find large percentages of organizations are already engaged in some form of intelligent automation. Many recognize it as a major technological breakthrough that has the potential not just to improve, but to transform the way they do business. Companies that aren't experimenting with this capability risk falling seriously behind. They need to move quickly if they hope to remain competitive. What is intelligent automation? As discussed previously, automation has been around for many decades. By now, it has been applied across a large spectrum of business functions through all kinds of technologies designed to improve performance with human-machine combinations. What makes an application of automation intelligent? In simplest terms, it only means that the automation solution relies on some kind of cognitive technology, such as, but not always, AI, to arrive at good decisions or recommended actions. This is a good moment to underscore that while many people tend to use the terms AI and intelligent automation interchangeably, they are not the same. An intelligent automation solution does not always need the power of natural language processing, machine learning, neural networks, or other capabilities of AI, and certainly, many applications of AI have nothing to do with automating tasks in a production environment. The two intersect when the power of AI is utilized to take in historical data, find patterns in it, and make predictions based on it. In their most sophisticated form, intelligent automation solutions can evolve their own capabilities to recognize problems and figure out how to solve them. Just as a human mind grows more knowledgeable and capable because of its inherent capabilities to associate cause with effect and learn from that feedback, machines equipped with AI can analyze data, make decisions, observe what follows based on those decisions, and make adjustments to try to do better. Each iteration serves to further refine the algorithm and increase the intelligence level of the automation. The machines learn by generating recommendations and self-remediate over time. In some situations, it becomes possible to automate automation, to use tools to spot opportunities for better use of tools. In most situations, learning systems can adapt and improve the more they work. We already see the impact of intelligent automation in our lives every day. Netflix provides recommendations to viewers based on AI-powered personalization algorithms. Nike, the athletic footwear apparel and equipment company, has developed a system that customers can use to create designs for their shoes through an augmented reality experience and leave the store wearing them. Surgical robots that diagnose deadly diseases, like cancer, are demonstrating the impact of AI in healthcare. Across many industries, both business-to-business, B2B, and business-to-consumer, B2C, chatbots and virtual assistants are answering common customer service questions related to billing, product information, and services. Automation of these straightforward interactions proves popular with customers because it allows them to get things done at any hour and far more quickly. There are numerous ways in which intelligent automation is redefining possibilities and powering new levels of performance across business functions, from marketing and customer engagement to finance and accounting and more. Smart tools, also known as intelligent systems, are being deployed to support optimized processes with sophisticated information processing capabilities. Intelligent automation applies more and less advanced forms of automation to thoughtfully designed business processes to improve the performance of those processes, sometimes by orders of magnitude. For instance, intelligent automation can elevate the customer experience by not only managing predictable processes, but also tackling more complex decisions to dramatically speed up systems and transactions. Even without AI-level capabilities embedded in it, intelligent automation has the power to fundamentally change traditional ways of doing business, both at the operating level and at the level of individual workers and customers, such as computational speed, accuracy, and the ability to cut through complexity that are different from, but crucially complementary to, human skills. Rather than threatening those currently in the workplace, intelligent automation is invigorating workforces by changing the rules of what's possible. people and technology are together doing things differently and doing different things. The steps to intelligent automation maturity. Beyond being a set of technologies and ingenious solutions, intelligent automation should also be thought of as an organizational capability. Gaining most value from it depends on growing an organization's knowledge, skills, and other foundations. Today, most companies have only nascent capabilities, and some have not even begun the journey toward intelligent automation. Only a small minority made investments very early and have devoted by now sufficient time and focus to grow what we would call mature capabilities. As always, however, the creative and experimental forays of these pioneering companies show others the possibilities and to some extent also pave pathways for them. One way of depicting the spectrum of organizations from least to most mature is to define five levels, reflective mainly of the why of their automation efforts, that is, what is driving them to invest in intelligent automation. What we have noticed is that as an enterprise matures in its capability, its managers' understanding of the opportunity they are addressing evolves. One study depicts this evolution as rising levels of capability and indicates the differences involved both in the technologies applied and the sophistication of the teams implementing and using them. This is not to imply with these stair steps that a given organization's journey has to be sequential, that a company cannot, for example, go to level 4 until it has gone through levels 1 through 3. This is especially true given that companies are large, complex entities in which different parts of the operation are often investing in automation solutions of different kinds. A back-office team, for example, might be using robotic process automation to relieve its people of routine, time-consuming tasks, while a front-office team is busy building a data-driven solution to take a service offering to the next level. It is true that, to some extent, the five stages in the model represent a natural progression, whereby the accomplishments made at the lower levels lay the foundations for higher ones. Any automation solution integrating AI, for example, depends on the availability of data sufficient to train, test, and continuously operate the tool.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.